absolute place to try and drive some of this agenda forward. So I suppose the most important thing after all of that is what practically could we do that you'd like to take away with you today?
I'd certainly just on just the skills brief as well to get that round or get everyone's agreement that that's the right scope. Because I think skills has come through strongly, so I think that's something that I really like to use for today. Coming back to that play shaping things as well, and just when you said then Fiona really made me think actually, you know, there's lots of organisations around the table who are could contribute towards the regeneration agenda just in terms of their presence as well. So new civic centres, looking at how we join up on some of that things as well. So if we're looking at Birkenhead and the regeneration of Birkenhead Town Centre, how do we work as organisations to maybe provide some anchor developments there as well, and really start shaping that place as a partnership. So if I think that through further, and maybe
talk to you. But would it be helpful if we all nominated a key link within the organisation, could operate as a network, so that we start to build a conversation more broadly with that person? Mm-hmm. I mean, in some areas there might be multiple people being connected in different ways, but it's a starting point for maybe you drawing some people together with our support. To say pursue this, and all the and there'll be a particular attempt, but particular part was very keen to
promote it. So how do you practically do, is it just a question of people letting you know?
Yeah, you know, let me know, and then
who the best person in your organisation are for Alan to
for a starting point. As in what we could perhaps do is do a regular update on things, and we can just cascade it out to the membership so that people know what's going on and have a way of
I'll connect them on to the skills brief. Also, I'll send around me or the health related work assistance report would be a good one, I think, in terms of the discussion points we had today. And then whether or not people thought it was useful if they come back to talk about something like rural waters or some kind of regeneration schemes as well.
Yeah? Okay. Sounds like a good offer. Great. Alan, thanks very much for that. I think it stimulated a lot of interest, so we'll definitely kind of follow up on that. Okay? Right, let's move on now to item 5, review of the health and wellbeing strategy and the world plan. Rose, could you want to do this, please?
Thanks, so I think the previous discussion was really helpful in terms of starting to open up some of the questions around kind of wider strategic role of this board, not least in relation to the growth plan, but in relation to some of the other strategies coming out of the Wirral plan. So useful link there, I think. So just to kind of set the context, at the Health and Wellbeing Board development session back in January, I brought an update in terms of the rural plan and the emerging strategies. And I think the discussion went something along the lines of how does the plan and strategies fit with the kind of core work of this board? And what are the kind of really priority areas that this board might want to focus on in terms of the day job that you do as partners, but in terms of delivering some of those strategies in the plan as well? And how can we determine what our priorities are within the board in terms of those strategies and moving forward, certainly as we move into implementation of those strategies. And I think so we were tasked to sort of go away and do a bit of further thinking around that and bring something back to the board that would maybe help you to sort of prioritise the kind of strategies and themes that are really going to be a focus for you in the next few months. So what the note does is set out a bit of background information where I've tried to start making the linkages between health and wellbeing board priorities that have been developed in the last year or so and the emerging strategies coming out of the world plan. And I guess the question is, when you come to it, is are the thematic linkages that are set out in figure one within the report, are they correct ones? Are there any that we've missed? And are there any additional cross-cutting themes that we really want to pick up in terms of looking at those strategies? I'm thinking of things like mental health. So, you'll probably recall last year I referenced section one sets out strategic responsibilities of health and wellbeing board, and I think it's important to keep an eye on those really because they are sort of core business and core strategic and sort of responsibilities. Paragraph two looks at the development of the draft health and wellbeing strategy that I think you spent some time looking at last year. And I understand that from that there are a number of priority themes that emerge that are set out in that section really. So I think there were four clear themes coming out of that. So I guess it's thinking they're still the priority themes for the board and how they fit in the work of the emerging plan and world strategies. in the column on your left of that table, those are the health and wellbeing board draft priorities. Now, I guess the first question is, do they still feel like they're the right priorities? And if so, have you started to make a correct recommendations across in terms of the Wirral pledges and strategies?
Are people still comfortable with those health and wellbeing priorities in that first column? Is there anything missed out, or are we broadly okay with those themes? Yes? David?
I suppose it's been dry, but I can see one of the big things that you quite rightly identified, Fiona, about the GSNA was social isolation, and really addressing that is a significant issue that then leads to all sorts of health and mental health problems. That's not jumping out at me, but...
Just to give you an example of that, it is a really important issue, you're quite right, and we have been there. Actually, where it comes out is in the aging well strategy, the entire theme on that around older people, it connects into the children's agenda because young people feel isolation as well. There are various groups. So hopefully what we can make sure and test out is that issue. It's one of those cross-cutting things because it connects over. Our check could be, is it there? Can we see it? Is it visible? And is it likely there? What we were keen discussing this with Rose is not to reinvent the new strategy, because we've got plenty of strategy for all the health and rural work, all those sorts of things going on. So it wasn't about writing another strategy on top of all of those. It was trying to find the synergy between them all so that we could understand as a board how these things could deliver our priorities, and where, as Rose said before, where we want to focus our energies and effort over and above what we would do ordinarily, I suppose. So it's, you know, we do our day jobs, we're going to do some of those things, whether this board existed or not, frankly. But the question for us is, where are the areas where we're going to make a step change? And we know we're quite keen to see us feeding back on progress against those things and understand that we're having a dashboard that we feel like we've made an difference at the end of each 12 months. So a lot of these things will happen when we just, and sorry Rose, I'm diving into your presentation, but in terms of that column in there, some things we'll want to influence and be connected into, but other things we might well want to read, and I think your suggestions are there, aren't they, as well as some other things to think about.
These are just suggestions that I thought seem to be the kind of priority areas based on those four sort of strategic priorities that the strategies are moving forward on, and that you might be particularly interested in sort of keeping an eye on and checking performance and looking at blockages and where you can actually make a difference as we move into implementation.
Okay.
There are suggestions for discussion.
Okay, so Graham,
it links pretty much to Fiona's point there, in terms of what we've got is we've got this very broadly strategic Wirral plan pledges, haven't we? And underneath those, we've got a number of detailed action plans. And I guess within those action plans, some areas that we absolutely must deliver on. There's a lot of stuff around healthy Wirral as a whole area that is one part of two of these pledges, but actually there's a lot that needs to be delivered in there. So I think there is something about us understanding the must-dos and the kind of the longer term things that are going to happen as well. So I don't think it is as simple as day job and not day job, because reshaping urgent care is absolutely our day job, but it's also absolutely our do or die issue here as well, isn't it? So we've got to find a way of balancing those things, and I'd like to see this in a possibly a more pictorial sort of way, with maybe a stratification in terms of those really urgent things and those things that are longer term and that we can keep an eye on. I think it's just something about understanding in that kind of context, whilst bringing together, I think, the Wirral plan pledges and the healthy Wirral objectives. I think that would help us all, wouldn't it?
Okay. Yeah. Rose, do you want to
add
on? Do you want any more steer?
It's
on
some
this
steer on
figure one.
Well, does it feel like it's starting to make a bit of a strategic fit between the priorities and the emerging strategies, which I think largely should be delivering the kind of priorities that you agreed last year? I think there is further work to be done as we look at action plans for the strategies, so maybe some of the detail will emerge. or to assist in implementing. So I'd be grateful for a steer on that. And then what I've suggested as well is there seems to be a natural linkage between board members and some of the strategy development anyway, and does that sort of feel right? And could those people be almost champions for that strategy and that activity that would be responsible for sort of bringing back something to this board? And those are the kind of questions that we sort of wanted Steve on, I think.
Okay, so what are the ones that we think are really, really important? Julie?
I was going to make another point.
Oh, you know, I thought you were going to answer that question.
For me, there's just something about us trying to flesh out with some conversations or examples. I think a bit like going back to the discussion around growth, what we actually mean by influence. Because it could be we're very interested and we have good conversations, like Fiona said a bit, but then it doesn't actually shape things any differently. So, because I think possibly we might struggle with what we mean by influence. How do we as a board actually make a difference? Mm. And it's in here, personally, it says that.
There's a brief descriptor around what do we mean by lead, influence, and be informed. And that's really up for debate, because people might think there's a different perspective that we want to play into that.
Because the logic would be the ones that we lead on are the most important ones, aren't they? There's two.
The other issue is that how it all fits in with the Wirral partnership as well, because we don't want to duplicate. No, yeah. People sit on both boards and they want to create another layer of.
Sorry, John.
That's fine, Phil. Just colleagues may or may not be aware of the need for local systems and systems greater than that of their local population to start to work together and develop what's called sustainability and transformational plans. It's probably not for today, but it might be worth the Health and Wellbeing Board being briefed on exactly what they mean. But I think that it would be really useful for us to have a read across between those sustainability and transformational plans, both at a Wirral level, at a Wirral and West Cheshire level, and at a Cheshire Merseyside level. That's the three kind of levels that are being discussed. Because what you don't see in here is things like access to primary care services 7 days a week, delivery of the constitutional standards within the NHS, etc., etc. But I don't think that it's not an insurmountable task to bring the NHS priorities with social care priorities, with Healthy Wirral and these into one place. And in fact, I've been doing some work with colleagues around that the last couple of weeks. So I just for today I'd offer to work with Rose to try and pull something together for our next meeting that begins to map that out. And I wrote on Alan's presentation a nice graphic on interconnectivity. Because actually I think this this describes it really quite nicely. And with his permission, I'll plagiarise it. And I think we could use it. Some of us see in words, some of us see in pictures, and I'm a picture person, to see how we can connect all those things into the same place. Because the theme here today has been connectivity, hasn't it? Between the growth plan and the things that we're thinking about, Health and Wellbeing Board priorities and the Healthy Wirral priorities. We do need to pull them together. So I'd suggest that if I could
I think that'd be fantastic. But can I take you back to Rose's question for us? And I guess it's the question that we always ask, isn't it? How can we add value as a board to all of this? Because we've got other partnership groups beavering away at these individual strategies. But where do we as a Health and Wellbeing Board fit in, and where is our added value to this whole agenda question? Because we don't want to duplicate what all the partnerships are doing. That would just be a waste of time.
Because a lot of our earlier discussions were about making sure that we had alignment, so connecting so that we don't have things happening in silos. And I think that's really helpful. Yeah. And also making sure that we are clear who's leading on what against our priorities. And I think that's quite difficult because it's a complex agenda, obviously, as well. But it's trying to ensure that against our priorities, are we clear who's leading and what success looks like?
Yeah, well,
because we're not going to try micromanaging
here,
but what you're going to be keen to understand is, are we getting the outcomes that we wanted? So it's something about, are we clear what success looks like? And then we can at least start to measure ourselves against that, rather than trying to get into kind of project management.
No, absolutely. Yeah.
I wonder if, picking up on the discussion we had around the growth project, out of that came some things that we thought it would be good to either connect into or add value to by engaging. Mm-hmm. And that those, for that particular strategy, were the way we can add value. We might need to put some more concrete sort of statements around it, but nonetheless, that is how we contribute to that particular thing. And I'm just wondering whether there are some things that we are heavily involved in and we engage in. We have a reporting mechanism, a way of working. Let's help the world. It comes here, we can do it. We have a way of that you join that. But we need some metrics to go with that to say what's going to be different. So we can do that piece of work to, you know, sort of make that a bit more tangible in terms of what impact that's having. But would it be helpful, like we've had the conversation about the growth strategy, to have a look at a couple of other key strategies to ask ourselves, how do we, and then start to build up that sense of how we can make a difference and what we would hold ourselves to account for working joined up with across the system. So if, for example, we were to look at the leisure strategy or the all age disability strategy or one of those other key strategies, then the question for us is, we're not necessarily the lead, but how can we use our power, influence, knowledge, skills, resources to take that a step change beyond and just identify a few key things that are around that and then have the substantive work that we've already identified that we need to do, because there's some stuff we have to do statutorily, so we just need to report on those things. And then, but there are other things that we can do a bit more, like the conversation we had about saying, well, we're going to need the right sort of workforce for the future, so we need to identify what sort of workforce we're going to need. We need to think about how we can help shape the place and where would we want certain things to be, how do we want to fit, how do we engage with them. We can add value by connecting our organisations into that, and as a result, we need something that was stronger. We might have a stronger bid to put forward to get the skills and get the college development and all those sort of things, to be X number of people trained in having skills that would enable them to take up jobs in the business and this could add value. So I don't know if I'm sort of helping to tease out some of that, because there's the stuff in here that I think we need to report on, we need progress, and we need to own certain strategies, we need to own and have that. And I think we put the suggestions in there because they've always been ours to own. So for example, the alcohol back a healthier lives, that's always been ours to own, that's why it's down there. I would suggest that actually the ageing well is a key one for us to own, as well as some of the children's one, actually, because in fact the work of the children's needs to fit in there. So maybe we need to own those strategies and have the dashboards from those coming back here, so we can understand again how we can max that out. So it's not replacing joint commission group, that needs to do all the work, doesn't it? But it's just, where does it sit, where does it anchor into, really? And how do we help with that agenda up our game?
So what practically do we need to do to make all that happen?
I think it would be quite good if we could practically construct a draft dashboard around the ones we absolutely need to own. Healthy lives, children's strategy. We have to own this all age disability, another one, would you agree? Domestic abuse, that is one that could sit with us, or we could sit with the community safety strategy, the partnership. I think that's kind of similar. But to say, like, okay, what are the key things we've said we will deliver in those?
Mm-hmm.
Bring them back as a dashboard and then think how we ought to perhaps bring some different ones back through, like the leisure strategy, like some of the ones that say, how how do we add value within the development of the place?
Just thinking, going back to why this is here today, was the original conversation, as I recall, was about the Wirral Partnership has got a series of strategies and pledges that it's got to deliver on, and it needs to sit that activity, certain activity, with different elements of what the current infrastructure is. So the Health and Wellbeing Board is a key role as part of that broader infrastructure. So this is about identifying what elements, what's our area of focus, and where are we going to add value. And we know that within each of these strategies that are identified, there's an action plan for each one, which I think then helps to develop the metrics that we would need to want to focus on, and then have a look at, well, how do we ensure that this happens to the maximum value for Wirral, whether it's the residents or visitors, I think.
I think the approach is, if we use those strategies that you've just listed, Fiona, as a starter, bring the actions and the metrics and the proposed dashboard back and ask a series of questions that are about, you suggested how you can add value to those.
Yeah.
And then that's a model, isn't it? And we can then look at applying it maybe to some of the other strategies further down the line. But I guess those are a priority. We can always test out that approach very specifically on those strategies, if that would help.
I think that would be really helpful, because my point is, I've read the words around influence, but it's, I think we could all have said those words a year ago. It's how we're going to do something different.
Yeah.
So it's almost modelling, running three or four strategies through in a very focused way, that we can evidence that we actually are doing something different as a consequence of this.
Are people okay with that as a way forward?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, great.
And
would it, good offer.
Can
yeah.
I, thank you.
Thanks
and
very
can
much.
Can I make a suggestion of bringing the housing strategies? One-to-ones we're bringing, because that is going to happen again. You can see a tangible relationship with that previous conversation.
Okay. Yeah, okay, sounds good. Great, thanks Rose. Right, let's move on to item six, which is 5-year forward view of mental health. Suzanne. Is that you, Suzanne?
I'm now Jackie and Suzanne.
Oh, right, okay, Jackie and Suzanne. Sorry, I'm not Suzanne.
Yeah, I mean, I think I might need to introduce myself. I'm Fawzi Allen, I'm the medical director for CWP. I think most of you know Suzanne. She's the locality service director on CWP. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to present a brief outline of the actual report, and then I'll hand over to Suzanne to present what's actually happening on the world. But the main thing which I think Sheena wanted this is for the board to commission a response to the report. Now the report was commissioned by Simon Stevens following the 5-year forward view to specifically look at mental health and kind of steer us in the right direction for the next 5 years. The group was formed in March 2015 and it was chaired by Paul Farman, the chief executive of Mind, with Jackie Dyer as the expert by experience and Cllr. And she was the vice chair. The report actually was published in February, and as I mentioned, it set out the vision for the next 5 years. What was good about the report, it actually gave us an indication of actually key priorities in terms of what we should be doing by which time, in various areas. One big priority was supporting people experiencing mental health in crisis, and you probably have heard lots of. John mentioned about 7-day working and how we ensure that 7-day working is part of mental health. Talked about various models and kind of talked about the fact that suicide is going to be one of the main priorities. So by 2020, we should be looking at reducing suicide by 10%.
Can I remind people to put their phones on silent? Sorry,
folks. It's fine, okay. Yeah. So that's one of the priorities. And as I mentioned, it actually specifically talks about numbers and what should happen by 2020, 2021. The second main priority is integrated mental health and physical health care. Because we've heard quite a lot recently about how we should be treating physical health and mental health exactly in the same lagging behind quite significantly compared to where we want it to be. And I think, you know, the good thing about this is, again, they've talked about specific numbers. It's all there in the report. I'm not going to repeat, you know, pretty much everything. But access to psychological support, you know, in people with physical health, you know, is quite important. They talked about the trust, physical, you know, acute trust, having the liaison services by which dates, and you know, kind of again gave us good steer, you know, in there. They talked about the fact that we need, you know, by 2020, 280,000 people living with mental health problem will have their physical health needs met. So again, you know, that's kind of, you know, not about target, but it's kind of specific things which they talked about. They also mentioned Vanguard and, you know, various Vanguards and the role for Vanguard in ensuring integrated physical health and mental health. They also talked about a specific area which is transforming perinatal care for children and young people. So they suggest that at least 70,000 people with, you know, children and young people each year will have access to high quality mental health care when they need it. So again, you know, that's quite relevant. That builds on the Future in Mind report, which was published in 2015. Again, in terms of access to access standards, which we have heard about quite recently, about early intervention team in psychosis and you know, IAP, they specifically you know, talk about percentages and what they want to see, 60% increase by 2020, 2021. A nice thing which they did also is they spoke about the models of payment, and they kind of, they were quite critical about the block contracts and how we should avoid, you know, that system. And they kind of mentioned about, you know, principles underpinning payment approaches in mental health, and the basically 12 principles which you know, say we should be, you know, quite careful about block contracts. We should provide care depending on you know, achievements and outcomes. They also kind of set, you know, so there will be specific groups which actually will help us to actually understand what they mean when they talk about outcomes and so on. So there will be both national and local outcomes which will be given to us, you know, in the near future. Again, you know, there's lots of things which they mentioned in terms of how we should be looking at, you know, at payment models as such. So I'm not going to repeat all of this, but the main thing at the end, they also talked about the extra investment which is required for mental health. They talk about £1 billion extra money which is needed. So that's not like, you know, the money, because we talked about £280 million a year which was needed to, you know, for mental health services. They talked about an additional £1 billion which is required by 2020. So that's quite you know, quite important for us to actually bear in mind. As I mentioned, the main thing for us, you know, from the Health and Wellbeing Board is to see, you know, to commission a response to, you know, to the report. I'll hand over to Suzanne so she can talk specifically about things which is happening at present, and whether that addresses some of the things which are in you know, in the actual report.
Okay, thank you. I think just in terms of taking a stock, taking some of the priorities that are identified by the task force, I think it would be necessary for this board, and I'd probably recommend that, to look at actually what we're achieving now and what do we need to do over the next 5 years. And that would need to fit into the STP that's currently being developed. So it's about that connections and pulling all of that together. And within the full document, it does talk very clearly about pulling some of the transformation around the Future in Mind, which is the CAMS transformation into that plan, and also looking in the learning disabilities transformation work as well. So, you know, at the moment, we know we've got pressures around acute inpatient care, and the demand is increasing within inpatient services. There's a directive within that to make sure that we're avoiding, where necessary, placing people outside of their local area, and making sure that repatriation takes place as quickly as possible. But there's a talk about eliminating any out-of-area placements in the next couple of years. So we really need to understand our acute care pathways that flow through the hospitals, and understand what are some of the blockages that happen to prevent people from having timely discharges. and we know then the impact that longer discharge, longer admissions have on people's level of functioning, and so we know that long hospital stays for people have a real impact going forward. We've got the work going on around first episode of psychosis, so we've had additional investments around how we can ensure we meet the 2 week time frame. So we've got a target of 50% to be reached. We're currently on track with regards to that. We also need to be linking in, again, it's that connection with people with severe mental illness to make sure that they're living safely. I think it, you know, fits in nicely with the growth agenda and what Alan presented, that they've got secure housing, they've got appropriate housing, whether that be an independent living or whether that's an extra care type of facilities. But to, again, it's about making sure that people are living local and we're not sending people far away from their maybe support networks. There's a big agenda around the reduction in suicide. We've seen an increase in suicides potentially between those 25 to 49, I think it's the age group that we've now seen an increase in. So again, that's very much connected to worthlessness, to poverty, to a number of kind of social determinants that we need to be addressing as part of the wider economy. And we also know that certain groups don't access mental health services. Some of the BME communities don't access our services, and LGB don't, and some of the hard to reach services as well. So we need to understand and work around why that is, and then make our services more accessible. Fawzi mentioned the work around making sure that we've got specialist services for the perinatal period, and we do have services working within our part that's part of our liaison service. What we don't have is that provision that's nearby for the mothers and babies, and sometimes they are going for, you know, a fair distance, you know, up to Newcastle sometimes, which if you think about, you know, that early attachment, etc., you know, isn't a good way to start life for the, you know, the mum or the child. We need to look at the mortality rates for people with severe mental illness and understand what that difference is and start working around that, and actually engaging people with a severe mental illness around their physical health. We know they don't engage with traditional mainstream services, so we need to be thinking about the different offer for this group of individuals. We know again that only 15% of people are accessing psychological therapies, and that needs to increase to 25%, you know, not just within an IACT framework, but also for people with severe mental illness and long-term conditions, and understand how that will impact on people's recovery. We also need to be promoting mental health and preventing poor mental health. So again, looking at the Future in Minds document, it's about promoting access to high quality care, and the work that we've been doing around the Future in Mind implementation and transforming is around inreaching, around primary care. So not just concentrating on tertiary or more specialist services, so it's input into schools and helping the schools develop programmes to prevent and support and detect and do the early detection, because we know early detection will help prevent young people then developing more serious mental illness and then the issues that brings along. Again, about increasing the number of people living with mental health is supported to find work, and we've had schemes in the past around individual placement schemes where individuals are supported to engage in employment and make those links with employees who are working, and they can go side by side. I think it's difficult because we didn't maintain that service at the time due to funding issues. But we've got a footprint there, we've got a blueprint there, and I think that service needs to be revisited if we're really going to address the worklessness within this particular group. And then there's also around the criminal justice pathway and the development of a justice pathway to make sure that people are being diverted away from the criminal system where necessary. And again, we need to think about how that plays out within Wirral. Because at the moment we've got Mersey Care providing that provision, so how do we make those linkages and how do we progress with developments, especially around street triage, because we've seen a real impact around street triage, just as a small scheme to discuss. discuss. And then, you know, I've spoke about the learning disabilities transformation agenda, the plans transformation agenda, and running along this, we've got the crisis care concordant as well. And Fawzi mentioned some of the different ways around commissioning, and at the moment we're entering into a kind of shadow year around an integrated provider hub, which is a different way of commissioning, and looking at budget programming, and looking at how we can become more focused around outcomes. So that's in development at the moment.
Okay.
Two things in at the end. Like from the report point of view, they actually specifically talk about mental health remaining a key priority for the NHS for the next 5 years. So they actually repeated this, you know, a number of times. But also, you know, what they kind of mentioned that the task force recommended the creation of a mental health advisory board, which we report to. So we need to have a mechanism to actually inform the mental health advisory board in terms of what we are doing as, you know, as a health economic as such.
So can I ask? I was struck by this finding that £1 billion additional investment will be required to make these improvements. So the government agreed that?
They have no choice because you know, they've commissioned this.
So the government pledged that money, have they?
No, but we hear lots of things about pledging money, whether it's real money, I don't know.
No, I'm genuinely interested because that's a big commitment.
We've got Richard here, so maybe he could tell us.
I haven't got £1 billion, unfortunately, to get, but...
What have the government said about the extra money, though, that's needed?
There's money within John's already talked about the sustainable transformation planning process. Obviously, part of that is there's some money, some next year, trajectories. I must admit, I can't update on that £1 billion. I can go away and actually try and find out.
It would be interesting to know if that money's been committed.
Yeah. Because they specifically mentioned a number of times that this will be an additional extra, you know, like on top of the 280 billion.
Yeah.
And they kind of specifically said for 2020.
But it says NHS England has accepted the recommendations in the report. Does that include the billion?
That's a very good question.
Chair, as I was going along in my car today, I was listening to Prime Minister's questions, and that was one of the questions that was raised with the Prime Minister by one of the MPs, and his answer was vague. He said Simon Stevens had identified that we would need £1 billion extra. So the question indicated that there had been severe cuts in mental health services in the last 4 or 5 years. So he said, Simon Stevens said that we would need an extra one. He didn't say the government, so I don't know.
It would be really useful to get some clarity. So, that's pretty fundamental.
I think it is quite clear that if transformation is going to happen, then there is the need for additional investment. It's quite clear that the investment isn't there, then the transformation that's set out in the 5-year
plan
review is not going to
happen. It's extremely rare when you see a really good report which specifically tells you what you need to do. So basically they've given us the task in terms of this is what you're supposed to be doing. And with the calculation, now if you look at my calculation, £1 billion is like a tiny drop in the ocean. But still, at least, you know, there is some indication in terms of telling us this is how much we will be giving you. But as I said, I don't know.
Yeah.
But they've accepted the recommendation, so.
Yeah. Okay.
I should say, I mean, there's a sustainable transformation fund that's being set up. That's, I think, there's about £4 billion in that fund, I think, from what we recall. And that talks about driving clinical priorities in terms of diabetes, learning disability, cancer, and mental health. So it's certainly in that fund. Whether it's got a badge and £1 billion on it, I don't know. I'll see what I can do to tell that.
Right, okay,
great. Part of the answer might be in 2.3, promoting good mental health, preventing poor mental health, and creating mentally healthy communities. But I actually just wanted to point out a specific recommendation for this board. It says in the paper, the joint local mental health prevention plans must be developed, and health and wellbeing boards should do this by 2017. So we're just talking about what our tasks are. So I think as a health and wellbeing board, we need to lead the development of a joint local mental health prevention plan, or at least be engaged with that.
Okay. So how do we do that? Can we take that forward?
The suggestion, I'm not even telling you, I don't like it.
I think when I was talking to Sheena about this, because I certainly imagine she's keen to have it discussed here, and it is important that we think about mental health and physical health as a board. And so I do think it would be useful to do a bit of a review, and that review to lead to the development of the plans as Graham mm-hmm. was describing. So I think we need some nominated leads to actually do that work. I'm quite happy to put somebody on the table as long with somebody from there. Graham's got a lead, I just think they need to be tasked with doing the work for us. But I don't know whether there's John to come in there.
Good, we've got John and then Phil. John.
So I've read this report and obviously welcome the task force report on mental health services. As an ex-psychiatric nurse, totally conflicted because it is a passion of mine. So I think that what's important for us is to think about what does this mean to Wirral residents? What does this mean to Cheshire and Merseyside residents? Because some of the services within here will not be planned just by Wirral, but will be planned across a much bigger footprint. So perinatal mental health is not something that Wirral can do on its own. It has to be a much bigger population. So I think there's an assurance mechanism in here for us. And the first one is, in terms of access to psychological therapies, in terms of early interventional psychosis, and in terms of dementia, how are we doing on Wirral? Their services that we have frontline staff involved in delivering now, and we've not done very well on those. So we have to improve our access to those services. And there is planning guidance for CCGs to be compliant with those standards for next year. And our current plans as a CCG is to be compliant with those standards. The problem with those standards is they're a minimum standard. And whilst we do have to achieve a 15% access rate for psychological therapies, because of the underinvestment of mental health services, perhaps that access rate should be higher. But we are planning to deliver the minimum standards next year. That's assurance to this board. There are then a number of services, such as perinatal services, such as psychiatric intensive care services, where we've always consumed our own smoke, if you like, but patients are now being placed out of the area, which is not acceptable. But that's not something that we can do on our own. It's going to have to be planned across a much bigger footprint. So I just wanted to sort of put that in context, because then I think it comes to, well, does the Health and Wellbeing Board, in response to the question, want to commission a report? Well, to be truthful, I'm not sure what the value of that would be, because I think this is part of the emergent strategic plan that we need to have for all CCGs, because what the report would tell us is what we already know, is that